Hello and welcome. In this tutorial, we'll train an object detection model with the data we split and pre-processed in the previous tutorial in this series. We will learn about the training parameters and how to observe the training process. For this video, I use a slightly shortened version of the second example program of the series that comes with HDevelop. As in the previous example, the paths and parameters are defined all together in the first section of the program. To adapt this example for your own application, you'll mainly work in this part of the example. First, let's talk about the learning rate. The learning rate is one of the most important parameters affecting whether a training works well or not. The learning rate determines how much the model parameters are updated during training. Ideally, your loss curve should look something like this. The loss function compares the prediction of the network with the ground truth of what is expected in the image. Differences are considered loss. To optimize the model, the training tries to minimize the loss. If we set the initial learning rate too low, the training takes a lot of time. On the other hand, if we set the initial learning rate too high, an error might occur. If the curve looks good initially, but then flattens, you should try and decrease the learning rate. Then the model might improve further. Here we create a change strategy for the learning rate that reduces the learning rate to a tenth of the previous value after 30 epochs. One epoch has passed when all training images have been processed by the model once. A deep learning training consists of multiple epochs to find the best model parameters. Since all your training data probably doesn't fit on your GPU all at once, the batch size defines how many samples are processed simultaneously. It is worth mentioning that these parameters are not HALCON specific. They are common to deep learning training in general, and there are many evolving strategies and recommendations on how to choose the best values to obtain the best training results. In this example, we use augmentation to diversify and extend our training data. Here we mirror 50% randomly along the row axis, column axis, or both. This can help with a better generalization of the model. However, you should not simulate variations that don't also occur in the validation and inference data. By default, during training, the performance of the model is only visualized using the validation split of the dataset. Here, I set selected percentage trained samples to 20 to also visualize the evaluation of the train split. We'll see the effect in a moment. Note that the computation of these evaluation measures can take a lot of time. To speed up the training, you can also evaluate less frequently. With all these parameters set, we can start the training. In the right window, you can see the pre-processed images on top, the labeled data in the middle, and the current results of the model at the bottom. Ideally, you can see how the model gradually learns to detect the instances. In the left window, you can see some information about the training progress and parameters. The plot below shows two different visualizations. On the one hand, evaluation measures for the validation and training splits are displayed. The mean AP, the mean average precision, is a measure between 0 and 1 that represents how well the predicted bounding boxes overlap with the ground truth bounding boxes. During training, the last model and the best model, according to the best validation, mean AP, are written to file. Additionally, the learning rate is visualized. On the other hand, the learning rate is also visualized combined with the loss I mentioned at the beginning of this video. Let's speed this up. You can see here how the learning rate is adapted just as we specified it initially. When the training is finished, it's time to evaluate the performance of this model in detail, which we will learn about in the next tutorial. Thank you for watching.